God bless you.
Good evening, sir.
Information service.
I was in Indian Information Service. In last December, I joined the Indian Police Service.
Oh, okay. So how did you find the Indian Information Service?
Sir, I liked the training process. I was there for around 5 months and we had our training back then. So very good service, so very diverse, lot of opportunities. Personally, it was a very great experience.
Did you see it as a propaganda service or a real serious investigative agenda?
So not exactly both of them. Actually, information service has different roles. We are usually the spokesperson of Government of India for the government schemes, and we also manage All India Radio and other agencies like Doordarshan, Press Information Bureau, Publications Division. All of them come under the information service. So I would not say it's an entirely propaganda organization service. I think yes, we do talk about government schemes, we give them publicity, but still we also have some technical work to do, sir.
So what is your take on this fake news and how to deal with it?
So fake news is a reality today and it has a lot of concerns, especially in the domain of security, sir. When we look last year, there were many incidents across the country where people were killed because of fake news. Fake news is a big threat, especially because in a digital world where everyone is creating content. And tackling, so we need 2-pronged initiatives. One is at the awareness level, dealing at the awareness generation, telling to the public about good news, how to believe news. And the second one would be technological tools, sir, which government has already proposed some draft rules to ensure that WhatsApp and Facebook play their role in controlling the fake news.
You are an IPS?
Yes, sir.
How do you find police training? You are still in training or you
are finished? I have taken extraordinary leave, sir.
Okay.
I was not part of the training. Okay. I was just there for 3 days, joined it, and then I came back.
And you are from Telangana?
Yes, sir.
So tell us about Telangana. What difference has it made when they formed this state?
So Telangana is the youngest state of Indian Union, and for the past 5 years there have been very good growth rates, double-digit growth. Average growth has been above 9%. And also there have been many good schemes which the government has brought up. Raitu Bandhu scheme, Raitu Bima scheme, Mission Bhagiratha, Mission Kakatiya, which have been model schemes and praised by Niti Aayog also. So I think the state is doing quite well, sir, Telangana. And also many jobs have been created, new firms have come. I think state is doing quite well, sir.
Do you think other big states like UP, Madhya Pradesh, they should also be broken up into several?
So with respect to Uttar Pradesh, I think yes, sir, because administration will be easier and it is also proposed by many commissions also. But it should not be the norm, sir. Like when we look at Madhya Pradesh, for example, Jharkhand, for example, it has broken up from Bihar, but the growth rates have not been very good. So I think small states are required, but it is not the panacea for better development. That's it.
You know, the idea of separate Telangana, it's a very old one.
Yes, sir.
But how come, you know, it took so long?
So
why was it not given at that time?
So 1956, when the State Reorganization Commission itself was there, it had recommended a separate state for Telangana. But back then, Hyderabad was the only region which was well developed. So, and the leaders from Andhra region were quite prominent in Indian National Congress back then. So they had done good lobbying to ensure that Telangana stays with the remainder of Andhra Pradesh. But now, for the awareness has come to a certain level that people across the state have demanded a new state, sir. So awareness has come like that, and also political atmosphere was conducive for new state. So multiple factors have played a role in the state formation, sir.
Yeah. You are from Pitts Pilam.
Yes, sir.
Premier Institute. There are several technologies which are disrupting international relations.
International relations?
Among others. How do you look at this? What are these new technologies which are disrupting international relations
and also generally the world.
So international relations, I cannot exactly specify, sir, but some technologies which are disrupting are the new technologies like artificial intelligence, big data, the Internet of Things which has come, and also gene editing through CRISPR-Cas9, which is a gene editing enzyme. It is also another technology which are disrupting across. And yes, currently I can recollect only them, sir.
You think China has an advantage over the United States in artificial intelligence?
I'm not very sure regarding that.
Okay. And personally, do you use social media?
I use, yes sir, I use Facebook, WhatsApp and also Instagram, sir.
Okay. And what kind of content do you put in your Facebook?
So usually I put photos, sir. Whenever I meet my cousins or family, I try to put some photos. And whenever I achieve something or I feel to tell something, just post on Facebook. That's the only limited use. For texting, I use WhatsApp. This is the limited use of Facebook.
Do you follow Twitter or Instagram?
Yes, sir. Instagram. Yes, I use Instagram. I follow the handles like Press Information Bureau because I was in information service. And also I follow the Prime Minister's handle in Instagram. Yes, sir. I follow many cabinet ministers also on Instagram.
Do you follow Donald Trump?
On Instagram, no, sir. On Twitter? Yes, sir.
So how do you react to his Twitters?
Sir, I think he is the only national leader who still continues to operate his account himself. And his number of tweets per day is among the highest of all the leaders. And he has also started something called Twitter governance, where he tells about big decisions of the government on Twitter itself. So he has revolutionized the forum and he has used it for governance also.
But what is his impact on American society, government and for the world?
So I think it's quite disruptive, sir, what he has brought up. He has started that entire anti-globalization things. America had been the biggest beneficiary of globalization, but today he is doing his best to make America great again, an inward policy. And also his foreign policy initiatives have also been controversial, sir. He continues to support Saudi Arabia and it's still bombing Yemen and also Israel when the Palestine issues are going on. So I think he has a unique policy. And the recent government shutdown, sir, that was there for 35 days, but also the reason was building a wall, which is also another disruptive change which he has sought for.
And he's also threatening to intervene in Venezuela.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I think that is kind of justified.
So Venezuela is a sovereign country, sir. And according to UN rules also, unless there is a UN-backed UNSC's Security Council resolution, America cannot intervene, sir. But America is doing it in an indirect way by funding the opposition leader. And it has also said that opposition leader is a recognized leader. We do not recognize Nicolas Maduro. That's what they are saying, sir.
Now, Home Ministry recently issued a directive authorizing some security agencies like the CBI to intercept electronic communication.
Yes.
So what's your take on that? Like, is it an invasion of privacy or is it required?
Sir, with respect to the national security, some kind of interception is needed, sir. Especially when many terrorist organizations are also known to use social media for recruiting people and also for planning all these attacks. So I think it is necessary, but there should also be some safeguards, like the Home Secretary approval. So there has been some controversy in that, sir, because the rules still say that Home Secretary approval is necessary, but many media newspapers have said that it has been removed. So I think that approval is still needed, and I think the agency should be given that power, but we must also recognize privacy, especially after the Puttaswamy case, Puttaswamy judgment. I think we should strike a right balance between that, sir.
Okay, and what do you think on what would be our approach to tackling the issue of Naxalism? How can we firstly, what is the approach presently and how can we modify, or if you can suggest any changes in that?
So currently government follows a two-pronged approach, sir. It also focuses on development and also at the security level initiatives. So at the security level, it has come up with some strategies like Samadhan strategy, training the locals in taking up fight against Naxals, like Bastaria battalion, which has come up. And also development initiatives are taking place at a fast rate. So road deployment plan has come. Mobile towers are being built. Many bridges are being built. So this is the current strategy. So it has been a dual-pronged approach. And the success, if you say, it has been a mixed things. Like when you see, look at Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, our states have mostly ensured that it has been a limited extent. One is because of the Greyhounds model, which was very, very successful, and also development taken at the ground level. So this was the approach now. So I think this can be replicated in other areas also. But one aspect which I think can be forest rights acts. One reason why left-wing extremism is still there is because many tribals are continuing to move towards left-wing extremism. So if we implement the Forest Rights Act in letter and spirit, I think we can definitely ensure that left-wing extremism is cut to a lot of extent.
Regarding that, you mentioned about involving the people, right? So yes. One model that was tried was Salva Jodho. It generated a lot of controversy. So do you think like that's an appropriate model?
No, sir, I do not think that was an appropriate model. That was envisaged to ensure that community policing is there and community helps in that. But they have acted beyond what was their mandate and there were a lot of issues with them, sir. I think what we need is take the help of NGOs, anthropologists who have worked in these areas and ensure that you build a good perception. The trust is the issue. I think once we build that, we can definitely ensure that left-wing extremism is addressed to a large extent.
Like in Punjab, we tackled the Khalistan movement primarily with a very muscular approach.
Yes, sir.
Right? So, recently, say Sri Lanka, they have practically eliminated LTTE, right? So, again, basically a military approach. So, will you suggest that for also tackling Naxalism?
So, that should be a part of the policy, but it alone could not be the policy, sir. Because left-wing extremism has socio-economic reasons behind it. There are some issues of inequalities. There are some issues of land alienation. Unless and until we resolve these, even if we use a strong approach, as you have said, we cannot address the root cause. I think it should be a twin-pronged approach.
And how is India's relationship with Sri Lanka? How is it modified, like, since the elimination of LTTE?
So India currently has an FTA with Sri Lanka, sir. Our relations have been good. And also India is building the Trikonamali, some facilities in Trikonamali. We are doing well in that sense. However, some issues are persisting, like the case of fishermen and arrest, which is still there. And fishermen arrest, which is still there. And also the policy towards China. Until very recently, it has been very pro-China. And they have given their ports, and because of China's debt trap diplomacy, the Hambantota port, they could not pay back. And now China is occupying facilities there. So I think that is one issue which is still persisting, sir.
In fact, you think like India is, you know, in terms of the external security, we are in a problematic situation, you know, across the Indian Ocean region. Because even in Maldives and
yes,
Seychelles,
sir.
Please elaborate.
Sir,
and what do you suggest, like, how do we improve?
So China is following a string of pearls policy, sir. When we look at ports across India, not only in Sri Lanka, there is one more in Myanmar, there's a port, I can't remember the name. And Djibouti is another port. It is across the India, it's making a string of ports and it is trying to constrain India, sir. Because China looks at India as a potential competitor. And our policy, sir, should be what the Panch Sheet has called for. Invest in our relations, complete your projects. We have, India is very good in proposing projects, but our implementation at the ground level had been slow. Like the Kaladan multi corridors, multimodal transport corridor, they are also lagging behind. So I think projects implementation should be faster and also work in India's strengths, which is a soft power, use India, unique Indian culture and also other aspects like technology where we can help. Like we have helped Afghanistan a lot. I think that can be replicated in other areas also.
How do we tackle China particularly? You know, not just security, but for example, should we join OBOR? I mean, that is one option. Like, you know, should we like partner with China in OBOR and become a part of it, or currently we've been very wary, right? So please.
So with respect to the One Belt One Road, so it is affecting the autonomy of India and also our sovereignty, so, because it's passing through the Pakistan occupied Kashmir, and China had been reluctant to change it. So I think that is one regarding that. So in the present context, I think we should not join one belt one road. And tackling China, sir, we should follow a mixed policy, so multi alignment. We should try to form some alliances like Quad, which we have recently formed, and with like-minded countries like Australia, like USA, because China is an economic giant and its military power is beyond our match. So we alone, I do not think, can directly match it. So we should use a set of alliances, a set of better foreign policy with other countries to tackle China.
Okay.
You are right now an IPS officer?
Yes, sir.
Suppose you are posted in Nagaland.
Okay.
And you know Nagaland is a disturbed state. How you are going to handle it?
As a police officer.
As a police officer.
So since it's a disturbed state, so the powers of the army will be quite more than the police, policing powers, sir, with respect to the law and order situation. And my target.
Do you think that army should be called in civil administration?
So some extraordinary.
To maintaining law and order or dealing with the terrorism is the primary job of the police, I think. How do you take it?
So, but there it's more than the law and order, it's separatism, sir. They are demanding a separate country itself. And they are using state of art machinery and state of art weapons to fight against the police officers. I think army's help is necessary, but if the police is trained enough, I think even the police can take care of the security issues there, sir.
But without help of army, police is not going able to handle it.
So, in the current context, sir, I think army is necessary. Present situation, present readiness of police of Nagaland, unless and until they are trained, we cannot directly expose our police officers to deal with the separatists, sir.
Recently, or rather as on that also, there is a controversy over the entry in Sabarimala temple. So, how do you look at it? What is the controversy and why it is so long that the Supreme Court has to?
So, regarding the, there is a religious sanction behind it, sir. Because the people, the Lord Ayyappa is treated as a bachelor, lifelong bachelor, and when women go around him, it is believed that it is polluting in nature. It's the common perception, sir. But the Supreme Court has clearly said that it's against the dignity of women and also the rights of women and rights, their religion, right to follow their own religious freedom. It is also against their rights. I think it's this issue, we must allow women to the temples and also deal with the religious issues, because at this point of time when across the world, so many women are excelling in every sphere. We cannot ensure that this is a kind of untouchability, as a judge, Supreme Court judge, who has commented on this aspect. I think they should not be allowed, and we must ensure that women also get their rights to play.
Pastor, do you think that they should be, entry should be given to them?
Yes, sir.
What is Article 370 in the Constitution?
So Article 370 is about the Jammu and Kashmir, sir. It talks about the relations between the Indian Union and the state of Jammu and Kashmir. It defines the relationship between those two, sir.
But there is a controversy and that the Article 370 would be removed once we come to the power, something like the BJP election. What is that controversy?
So the controversy is Article 370 is not. Like many courts have taken the decision that it has come to a that situation that it forms a permanent situation or it is needed in the country. That's what many courts have also talked about. But government has said since we have the amending power, the parliament has the amending power, we can also change the article and ensure that the relationship is changed. So the main controversy is the parliament's power to amend the article, but there is no J&K legislative assembly, sir. Earlier, the article clearly says that any amendments must be taken, they should get the approval of J&K, not legislative assembly, constituent assembly, sir. But there is no constituent assembly, how can we make major amendments to the article, sir? That is the main controversy.
And what about this POK, Pakistan Occupied Kashmir, what is the controversy?
So the controversy is when in the 19 40s when the Maharaja of Jammu and Kashmir had signed the instrument of accession, whole Jammu and Kashmir belongs to India itself. So. But since by the time the Maharaja responded, there was some delay. Pakistan had occupied that area. And then Lord Mountbatten and also the former Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru had called for a ceasefire. By then Pakistan had occupied them. So though on paper that area is with us, in actual control it is still with Pakistan, sir. And in UN also there is an issue filed by the Jammu and Kashmir, filed by Pakistan. In the UN there is an I'm unable to say it properly.
Okay.
There's a case going on in UN also.
Why do you want to shift from IPS to IAS?
Sir, my main reason is I always wanted to become an IAS officer, sir. I got IPS, I'm happy with it. But my role model had always been Mr. Shankaran, who was an IAS officer from Andhra Pradesh cadre. He had worked a lot for the scheduled caste, scheduled tribes. So that was one more in motivation. And also the diversity which is there in India Administrative Service is one another pulling factor for me to join the Indian Administrative Service.
So how we are going to handle the political pressure there in Europe?
So political pressure will be there in both Administrative Service and also Police Service. Yeah. Because we are advisors, as civil servants we will advise the political executive and we form a part of permanent executive. But I am very patient and I have a lot of perseverance, that's what I feel, sir. So if with these traits I think I can manage the political pressure and be motivated and ensure that I am always follow the constitution and the rule of law.
Which is better, Telangana Police or Delhi Police?
Sir, I cannot exactly compare them, sir, because I am not into them. But both are doing good, and especially Telangana Police in terms of cyber security, they are one of the best in the country, sir.
What is the difference between the Delhi Police system and Telangana Police system?
So the Telangana police system is under the state government, sir. It is under the control of the Chief Minister of Telangana. However, the Delhi police is under the Lieutenant Governor LG and the central government ultimately.
Can you please elaborate a few challenges the police department is facing?
So first major challenge is the shortage of staff, sir. Many reports have said 20% shortage are there in both IPS and also the number of people. And also lower level there is corruption, sir. Cutting edge function is there still corruption. And the third point is accountability is also another issue. While police have a lot of power, accountability is another issue.
In my opinion, the biggest challenge is the perception of people towards police as corrupt. I think this is one of the biggest challenges.
Yes, sir.
So what steps can be taken to remove or to minimize this perception?
So firstly, if I am the SP of the district, sir, I will ensure that there is citizen friendly policy. Firstly, one of the main reason why police are corrupt at the lower levels, and I have spoken to many SIs and CIs, they told me that they do not get any station allowance, sir, because they need some expenses for the station. These funds are not given for them. So these funds I will ensure, I will talk to the Chief Minister and also the district magistrate and ensure that each station gets certain amount of funds. And the second one, sir, at the public level also, we can have some Mahila Police Volunteer system, which is there in Haryana and also in Delhi. These initiatives can be replicated there, where we go to the, each constable is allotted a division and he goes to the people, talk to them regularly and talks to them and tries to get into a rapport with them, sir. I think with this we can address to a large extent.
And why would you opt to choose anthropology as an option subject?
Sir, I was interested in biology, sir. And anthropology is unique in the sense we learn everything about humans. We learn about their marriage, family, kinship, and also about tribals. So it's quite interesting subjects. I just chose based on my interest.
Okay, and you are quite popular on social media also.
Popular? I don't think so. I follow social media, but.
You follow social media. What is your take on this Me Too movement?
So the hash Me Too movement, because there in 2018 and also in 17 was a movement where women came out against sexual harassment issues which were happening with them. So many women have got the courage to come out because they saw that fellow women have come and protested against what has happened to them. I think this was a good movement, sir, but there have also been some issues because some of them are involved in false allegations against some some people. So it has been a mixed moment. So there have been the positives of it, like many women came out. But the false allegations are one thing which we had to do it. Reputation was lost.
Many women. Such media should be regulated now?
So today in a digital world when everyone is a content creator, there is a limit for regulation, sir. I think it's more about awareness creation and empowering the public. Because regulation, when everyone is content creator, is quite tough. I think though it's necessary, as you have said, it must be to a limited extent, sir. We must work on the demand side.
One last question. Give us three reasons why we should not select you. Only three.
So currently, I don't see any reason why.
You don't have any weaknesses. You mean to say you are perfect?
No, sir, I don't say that. But since you have asked why you, sir, one weakness I have is I am weak in Hindi and I forget things often. These two are some weaknesses which I am currently working on. But I am always trying to improve upon my weaknesses, sir. So since I try to work on them, I don't think I should not be selected.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.